Okay.
If you will, turn to the back of the hymnal there to number 716 for the Apostles' Creed. And if you are able to, I'd ask that you stand as we go ahead and recite this in unison. It's a brief but very poignant creed, stating those things that we hold as dear, near and dear to the heart of our faith. The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our next hymn is going to be number 289.
First, second, last.
First, second, last. 289. Father God, we do come to you today, not only asking you for the showers of blessings in our life, but also the physical showers of rain that we may have on our parched land. Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit, that is the living water in our lives, that it would overflow over us, bringing us peace and comfort and strength as we continue to go and to be those witnesses that you call us to be. Father, for those who are not able to be with us today, we ask that you would be with them in a mighty way, even during this time period as we go through and worship you and lift up all the honor and praise to you. We ask that the Holy Spirit that abides within us would also have his way with this service. Lord, that you would be glorified, that you would be pleased with our worship to you today. Help us to focus on you and you alone. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning. You can already see, we're a little small today in number. I'll get to some of the details with regard to where everybody is this morning as we get to our prayer requests and praise items there, but I want to go ahead and welcome all of you to our service today. A brief reminder, 2 weeks from today, we will be celebrating the 90th anniversary of the founding of Green's Chapel and the ministry that God has provided through this particular church over the last 90 years. If you're not on Faith Life, I just would tell you that the church is going to be providing the main components of the meal that day. The one thing that we are asking for those that are able and would like to go ahead and do so would be to go ahead and bring a dessert. Just bring a dessert for that meal. We are going to have a large cake, birthday cake, if you will, also. But by bringing some desserts, it'll satisfy more of the sweet tooth that we have in a lot of us. Maybe not everyone, as well as give people options in terms of the dessert as well there. So that is the plan. Also, if you are kind of a key member or even not a key member of your extended family, if you can go ahead and give Janet or respond on Faith Life with regard to the approximate maybe number of people that's coming from your extended family. We're planning on right now, Beth, somewhere between 100, 125 or so. If you happen to know, Linda, that you're bringing 50, and we were only expecting, 45, that might be helpful for us to know. but please, if you can go ahead and provide those numbers, that would be helpful to us as well. We are going to have, at least for this week, a normal schedule with respect to. We need to have choir practice tonight to kind of go over the choir special at least. It may be a quick choir practice because we don't have our piano player. If we can have the choir practice at least to go over the choir specials, especially the one for the anniversary celebration, that would be very important. So let's at least do that tonight. We are going to have the Bible study Wednesday morning this week, but then following week, which is the week before or the Wednesday before the Sunday of the celebration, we're gonna not have Bible study that day. To go ahead and give us opportunity to go ahead and do things there in the fellowship hall as well as outside the fellowship hall, getting ready for some of the last minute details in terms of the celebration there also. Ms. Janet?
I would like to say one thing. We had a little sit-down with the loss of Gavin, but things are starting to, this next week you'll start noticing the signs that Linda and designed will be put up down here for people on the road to see. If you see something on Facebook, share it. So some people I try, and we just couldn't get touch with. We really try. So it's not that we try to leave anybody out, because we didn't do that purposely. But I know there's some, I know two people that I could not find. They may be the answer, or they didn't know where they were now. So I don't want anybody's feelings hurt.
Right.
We can help that. We can only see somewhere around 80 out there. So we're going to do a run over in these three rooms here for the table and chairs. And I'm going to pull those old chairs in the basement, spray paint them this week so we'll have chairs, adequate chairs up here. So I believe if we plan for 100, 125, I think we'll be safe. But we're just going to pray.
We'll see. Specifically on the back of the bulletin there, this is the first Sunday of the month. We will be celebrating communion here towards the end of the service. Ordinarily, we would have the second Sunday fellowship meal next Sunday. We're not going to because we're having the anniversary celebration the following week. So this week, normal Bible study. Next week, there will be no Bible study on Wednesday, and on, a week from today, there will not be a fellowship meal following the service either. Okay? Rick.
I have to use the microphone.
Oh, okay.
You're so crazy.
No. I was out in the fellowship hall working this week, and a lady came in while I was out in the fellowship hall, and she wanted some water to clean some tombstones that was in the cemetery. But she said, Ms. Hawkins said that she was a faithful watcher of the YouTube. And she has relatives out in the cemetery. But she said that she could not hear people in the audience whenever they said something and it wasn't on YouTube. They didn't know what was going on. So, Ms. Hawkins, this is for you and for anybody else that's out there. We have a dedicated pastor, and he gives his all. His birthday is this week,
last week,
and we have a gift card and some appreciation to our pastor. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Rick.
You do a great job.
That. Thank you.
So, for everybody out there in YouTube land, this is for you.
Thank you. And I apologize. I mean, Laura has also gone ahead and let me know that for those who listen, that they can't hear, and even sometimes even you here in the congregation can't hear other people because you're speaking this way and they can't hear you in the back. So I will try to do a better job of trying to repeat what people are saying even here, so that inside here you can know as well. Getting to the birthdays, yes, we didn't meet last week. Again, I want to thank you so much for your understanding with regard to the risk that we legitimately felt we had as a result of the COVID potential interactions there. Sadira has been very faithful to go ahead and include the birthdays that we would have had in last week's bulletin, as well as this week's as well. So you can see that Frank and I share the same birthday there. Nyoka is the day after that. Summer, which I believe is Tommy and Alma's granddaughter, had her birthday this past week as well. And then coming up this week, we have Lucas, Ginger, Mayreen, and then we also have in memory of Inez. Are we okay with skipping the happy birthday today, or do we want to sing it?
I'm just going to sing it.
Okay, we're going to sing it. All right.
We did last time.
Yes, we did. Okay, let's sing happy birthday then to Frank and Nyoka and Summer and Lucas and Ginger and Mary. And me. All right.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
I would like to just very briefly say it is a privilege, and it is my sincere privilege to be able to be called your pastor, and for the faith and the confidence that you have in me as your pastor, and the support that you have given to me, and I hope that I have been able to, in some small way, be able to do that same for you and for you personally as well as for your family. So thank you very much. With that, we will move on with the service here, giving thanks and glory to God for all of us as we go to our next hymn, which is really the bedrock of our faith, as Paul has gone ahead and I'm sorry. Yeah, we're not going to do that one because, yeah, we're going to, but that's okay. Take time to be holy. That's important too. So 441.
Just a minute, we'll find it.
Me too.
Okay.
Amen.
If you will, turn to the back of your hymnal one more time for our responsive reading today, which is 653, 653, not 53. And when we get there, when I get there, it's God's love. And I'm sure all of you are aware of this. I will read these sentences, paragraphs that are not in bold, and please respond in unison to those that are in bold. This is God's love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
But God commanded his love toward us, in that while you were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not.
He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love.
In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him.
Herein is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son for the propitiation of our sins.
Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another.
No man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us.
There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love.
We love him because he first loved us.
Amen. I would remind you that we continue to leave the offering plate in the back in the vestibule there. If you have brought tithes and or offerings to be able to give today, and were not able to do so as you walked in, you can avail yourself of that on the way out. In light of the fact that we have such a small gathering here today, rather than doing the choir special, which would involve at least some of us basically doing a solo during part of it, since some of our vital members, all of our choir members are vital, but we do have several that are out today. As a result of that, we're going to just sing a hymn here, which Brother Rick is going to tell us what it is. I hope. Aussie is going to tell us what it is.
262.
So this will be, as we were doing during the pandemic, this will be a congregation special, not a choir special. You are all part of the choir today.
Sure.
If you will take your bulletins and open up to the inside there, on the right-hand side, we have those that we've been praying for. Let me just briefly give you some updates. Mark and Mary are not here today. Mark had that procedure done on Friday. Unfortunately, his pain has come back with a vengeance, and so he is not here today. I inquired as to whether or not he's been able to maybe get in touch with Andrew Sports Medicine there and maybe get some answers and or maybe be able to see somebody. And so I don't know exactly what his current status is right now, but please continue to keep Mark in your prayers there. Carolyn, I'm sorry.
Tell me this morning when you called me that he's going to see if he couldn't see me in the morning.
Okay, so hopefully he'll be able to see him in the morning then. Okay. That would be, that. I'm sure for Mark at this point, the sooner the better. So, also, I got a text message from Carolyn Simmons early this morning. She's having some allergy issues, so that's why she's not here. Preston has a doctor's appointment tomorrow. To see the doctor and basically to get checked out with respect to his recovering from this last bout of COVID. He had COVID earlier or once before, and that was kind of a mild case. This has been a little bit more than mild for him, but he certainly hasn't been hospitalized or anything along those lines. Mary continues to be doing well there, but that's why they're not here today. Lindan is doing much better from her bout with COVID. Mike is still testing positive and still has some symptoms. So please go ahead and keep them in your prayers. Back to Mary and Preston just for a moment. I did talk with them yesterday, talked with Mary yesterday, and they're having the fatigue issue now as well. Still some lingering aspects there. I believe Brother Tommy said that Brother Ben and Miss Donnell are still out of town in North Carolina. So please be in prayer for them. I think they're supposed to come back sometime this week. So be in prayer for them. Jane Todd, her husband continues to test positive for COVID as well. She had it herself about 3 weeks or so ago, but in light of him having it and her being around him at this point, that's why she's not with us today as well. My mom ended up going to the emergency room this morning. She was having racing heart issues. It's not the first time she's had them, but my sister said that they went ahead and treated her and that they got that under control. And so she is back home at this point, although their trip that they've been trying to take now for three different occasions to go down to Florida and check out some potential new housing arrangements for them is being postponed yet again. I also had a cousin whose oldest son suddenly passed away this past week. He was 20 years old, and he died of an aneurysm. And so it was very unexpected, very similar to what happened, not necessarily the exact root causes, but the suddenness and the unexpectedness of Gavin going home to be with the Lord as well. So we want to continue to lift up the Gilliland family as they continue to grieve, especially Diane and Gerald, as well as Patty and Avery and Gabe and all of the family there. Just one other note, a very good friend and fellow elder that I actually became an elder with and went on to session at New Hope at the same time with him, God bless you, and one other person. He also passed away this last week, and Karen and I will be attending that funeral tomorrow. I also know that Matthew Hawkins was down at Grandview last night. I haven't heard anything new from Anita there. He was having some pain in some body areas and maybe kidney stone related or some kind of infection in the kidney there. So please keep Matthew in your prayers also. Brother Rick.
Heart problems.
choir practice. We will have a choir practice tonight. It may be short. We need to go over especially the choir special for the anniversary celebration, but it'll be a short one. Other praise reports or prayer requests? Okay.
I think she
does.
She
would
be able to move it wrong.
Okay.
But once she got a prayer,
that's faster. Okay. All right. So continue to keep Mary. Yeah. So for those of you who may not have heard Martha talk with Mary Baba, she's continuing to have some not feeling well episodes. She had really hoped that as a result of especially the last treatment, as well as the good report in terms of her being in remission, that she would be feeling better right now, but she's not, so we want to continue to keep her in our prayers also. Any others? I know that there are a lot of things going on, not only in my life, but also in your lives as well, unspoken requests. God knows them, and he's working on them, and at some point, he will give us answers to those prayers, and we're going to go to his throne room now, thanking him for his faithfulness and for his ability to go ahead and work in all these situations. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we come to you now just thanking you for this opportunity that we have, this privilege that we have, not only to be able to come and to worship you and to give you all the praise and honor and glory that you were due, but also, Lord, to be able to come into your throne room without the threat of harm to ourselves, knowing that as our Father and as we are sons and daughters of you, that you care about us, you want to know what's going on, although you already know, but you still want us to be able to come to you in faith and in confidence that we can bring our various petitions and supplications to you. But Father, we also bring to you our adoration and the worship that you deserve as we recognize and confess that all that we have and all that we do in life and all that we see in life even is as a result of your hand and your hand that goes ahead and brought all this about. We thank you for the breath that you breathe into our lives, the very breath that we have in our lungs even right now. We thank you for the healing that you're bringing to various people here in our church, as well as in our extended families and our friends, the network of our friends. Father, we especially lift up Brother Mark to you right now with this ongoing pain that he is having, for those that are struggling even with the aftermath of COVID right now. Lord, we ask that you would be with them. Father, especially and expressly for the Gilliland family and the loss of Gavin so suddenly and so unexpectedly, we ask that you would bring a peace and a comfort that only you can bring to them, Lord, that you would help them to be able to rejoice in the life and the gift that he was, as well as to look forward to the opportunity to be able to see him once again in the future. But Father, we do ask that you would help to soothe their grieving hearts, especially Diane and Gerald, Lord, that they would know your presence in a mighty way. And that, Lord, that that they would be able to stand upon your promises as they, as you lead them through this very tragic time, this very sad time in their lives. But Father, we do thank you again for the impact that Gavin had on so many people, and thanking you for the opportunity to have known him and or known of him. Lord, there are many other people, loved ones, various situations that are on our hearts right now. We trust that you are aware of each and every one of those and that you are at work in those, which is completely mind-boggling to all of us, especially me. But Father, we know that that is why you are God and we are not. We thank you for the word that you give to us. We thank you for the warnings that you give to us. And Lord, we thank you for the life that you have given to us as well. May we be those vessels that you created and purposed us to be even before we were born. We thank you again, and it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You can be turning to our scripture passage for today. In light of some of the things that are going on in our church and in our extended church family here, I'm deviating again from our study and our series on Ecclesiastes. And as I went through the lectionary passages for today, none of those really struck me or that God didn't lead me to them. He led me to Psalm 71. Verses 12 through 16 specifically, although I'm going to have to give you a little bit of insight into the context as we go into it. But if you will, please turn in your Bibles to Psalm 71, and I'm going to be reading from 12 through 16, and I'll be reading from the King James Version. This is the Word of God for us, the precious, precious people of God. Verse 12, O God, be not far from me. O my God, make haste for my help. Let them be confounded and consumed that are adversaries to my soul. Let them be covered with reproach and dishonor that seek my hurt. But I will hope continually and will yet praise thee more and more. My mouth shall show forth thy righteousness and thy salvation all the day. For I know not the numbers thereof. I will go in the strength of the Lord God. I will make mention of thy righteousness, even of thine only. Let's pray. Father God, I pray that this message of hope that you bring to your people would be the message that they hear today. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, I know that at least in my life, and I'm assuming in your life as well, that you have come to the realization, not today necessarily, but probably much earlier in your life, that songs are very powerful. Good songs, especially hymns that we have as well, have the ability to convey profound truths in just a few words. Now, you may not have ever thought of getting old as being a blessing from God, but it is. And along with the many blessings associated with getting old, there are also challenges, as you and I are aware, as well as responsibilities. Our scripture passage for today comes from a psalm in which we do not definitively know exactly who the author is. Some think that it could be David based on the similarity with other psalms that David is known to have written. Adding to the possibility of David being the author is that Psalm 71 is just one of two psalms in what's known as Book 2 of Psalms, which is Psalms 42 through 72. But it's one of the two psalms in that book that doesn't have a title, regardless of whatever translation, whatever your translation may show there in your Bible. This one does not have a title in the actual text of the Hebrew. And if you were to look also at the content of the psalm right before it, which is Psalm 70, you would see that psalm, which was written by David, that there are some themes and some topics that seem to flow very much from 70 directly into 71, which has led some biblical scholars and commentators to suggest that Psalm 71 might be a continuation of Psalm 70. With respect to that, it is important for us to remember that the Old Testament and the New Testament, as those were written, there were not chapters or verses. Okay, so it very easily could be that Psalm 70 and Psalm 71 were written in to actually be one psalm. But regardless of who the author is, Psalm 71 here contains both a lament, which is an expression of grief, regret, or sorrow, as well as thanksgiving for the recognition of God's faithful providence and protection in our lives. The lament here in Psalm 71 is described by the author with respect to the latter years of his life, where he is enduring real attacks and dangerous threats being made against him because of his older age and the weakness or distress that comes with old age. For example, look at verse 4. Verse 4 of 71, which says the following: Rescue me, O God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel man. And then continue, if you will, down to verses 9 through 11. which say, do not cast me off in the time of old age. Forsake me not when my strength is spent. For my enemies speak concerning me, those who watch for my life consult together and say, God has forsaken him. Pursue and seize him, for there is none to deliver him. Sadly, we are seeing far too much in our country today the total disregard, disrespect, and the devaluing of our senior citizens by the way in which they are being physically attacked, robbed, and even killed in broad daylight by brazen individuals and groups of people who see nothing wrong with physically taking what they want from them or just inflicting pain and injury on them. I don't think a week goes by in which at least I don't see at least one news story of how an older American has once again fallen victim to sinful and criminal activity towards them, with many being seriously injured or killed in the process. So we can see here then that the psalmist reveals his older age as he pleads with God, do not cast me off in the time of my old age. Do not forsake me in this time of my life when I don't have the strength that I used to have. For my enemies are seeing my frailty and my weaknesses as an opportunity to pursue and seize me as they believe, for they believe there is no one left to deliver me from their assaults, not even perhaps God himself. So that is why he calls out to God then in verse 4, rescue me, O God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel man. He calls out to God because he knows God and has known him from his youth and even before, as the psalmist writes in verses 5 and 6, for you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have learned from before my birth. You are he who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you. That last part he echoes again in verse 8, saying, my mouth is filled with your praise and with your glory all the day. Here in the verses leading up to verse 12, he gives us complete insight into his trust in God, being completely faithful and completely capable of being his rock of refuge, as he describes him in verse 3, that has provided and protected him in the past, a God he knows will continue to do so both now as well as in the future. And so as we move on then to verse 12 then, we see the heart of a faithful believer who has known the works of his faithful God and is once again calling out to God for help, as we read in verse 12, O God, be not far from me, O God, make haste to help me. Now I'm sure all of us today here can relate to this plea. All of us at one time or another may have felt that God was far off or distant, either didn't know what was going on with us or perhaps didn't care, of which neither are true, just lies that the enemy tells us because we aren't perhaps seeing God work in the way in which we may have wanted him to work, or because of the very trials that we are going through, wondering why God has allowed them in our lives to begin with. But this man isn't calling out to God as his last resort. He's calling out to God, who has been faithful all his life, in his first resort. Help me. Hear my plea. Come quickly and help me. What he's asking God for help with, he's already addressed it previously here in the preceding verses, but he reiterates the issue of his unjust enemies and their attacks in verse 13, saying, may my accusers be put to shame and consumed with scorn and disgrace. May they be covered who seek my hurt. Now, in verse 2 of the previous psalm, David clearly echoes those same sentiments as he writes, this is going to sound very similar, let them be put to shame and confusion who seek my life. Let them be turned back and brought to dishonor who delight in my hurt. Now, if you've ever heard the term imprecatory prayers, or imprecatory psalms, verse 2 in Psalm 70 and verse 13 in 71 are examples of them. I'm not going to try to take the time today to go through all and a very thorough examination or explanation of what these types of prayers or psalms are, but please be aware that there are examples of them both in the Old Testament and the New Testament. And while they may be somewhat shocking, you need to also be aware that they are not calls solely for us to try and use God for our own personal vengeance or vindication. You may remember in Luke's gospel, an account where Jesus and his disciples were traveling to Jerusalem. And rather than going around Samaria, they decided to go through it. Seeking accommodations then for the night, Jesus sent messengers ahead of him, but they were met with opposition specifically because they were Jews on their way to Jerusalem and were hated by the Samaritans. Luke tells us what happens next in verse 54 of chapter 9. And when his disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to tell fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" Now here in Psalm 70 and 71, the authors are not being quite so overt as to call fire down on their enemies to consume them, but they are calling for God's judgment and anger to fall on his enemies. In the Samaritan situation, Luke goes on to tell us that Jesus was not pleased with James and John's suggestion, as we read in verse 55 of Luke 9, but he turned and, what did he do to the storm? What did he do to the demons? What did he do to the disciples? He rebuked them. He turned and rebuked them. Jesus' reaction to James and John here, which likely earned them, although it's not definitive, earned them the not-so-glamorous nicknames of the Sons of Thunder, clearly shows their suggestion to call for the Samaritans to be destroyed by calling fire down from heaven did not come from the right heart or with the right motives. Yet later on in Luke's gospel, Jesus goes on to say the following in his explanation of the parable of the persistent widow and the unrighteous judge in chapter 18. This is what Jesus says. And will not God give justice to his elect, who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? So we do see then from Jesus himself that there are times in which the prayers of the saints will result in justice being served against the wicked, when the motivation is genuinely for God's righteousness, for God's honor, for his reputation, and for the triumph of his kingdom, but only after extended efforts and prayers for the enemies of God to come to repentance, forgiveness, and for their regeneration. It is in that context then that we understand the psalmist here in verse 13 asking for God's intervention with his enemies, which are really enemies of God himself, seeking to inflict evil and bring pain, suffering, and perhaps even death to one of God's faithful servants as they seek to block God's plans and purposes. Now, as we move on then to these last three verses that we are covering today, we see the mark of a mature believer with regard to his trust that God has heard his prayer and his thanks that God will respond. In essence, he is full of hope that God is going to help as he requested, although he has left it up to God as to how and when he will answer that prayer. And while he waits, we see three specific acts of this older believer that we too should take note of, looking to our own lives to see what level of faith is evident in our actions. So, looking at verse 14, we see the psalmist writes, "But I will hope continually and will praise you yet more and more." As we get older, as we begin to experience more discomfort from our own bodies beginning to fail, as well as watching friends and relatives go through the pain and suffering of their own bodies also failing, it can become harder to have hope, harder to remember what God has done for us and for us to continue to praise Him. A seasoned and mature believer who has experienced God's faithfulness throughout his or her life makes it a point to remember what God has done for them and relies on God's faithfulness to continue right up until he or she is called home, resulting in a hope then that lifts the heart to praise God frequently and continually. It's not, hear me on this, it's not that we are in denial about what is happening to us or to those around us. It's more so the recognition and the thanksgiving for what God has done for us. The opportunity to experience life to begin with, along with the forgiveness, reconciliation, and fellowship that we enjoy because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. It's seeing the glass as half full instead of half empty. It's counting our blessings instead of counting our heartaches. It's trusting that God is truly with us and for us and not far away or against us. The experience of God's faithfulness over a lifetime serves to create hope in us, giving us the reason and the ability then to praise Him. Moving on to verse 15, we see another example of the seasoned mature believer. My mouth will tell of your righteous acts, of your deeds of salvation all the day, for their number is past my knowledge. Praising God both in public and in private is part of the mature believer's life. But so is the simple act of telling others what God has done for them, giving testimony of the many things and the many ways in which God has blessed, provided for, and protected them. The mature believer is always ready to give God the credit for what he has done in their life. He or she is well versed on not only what the Bible records of God's mighty works, but also sees and seeks what God is doing today and is willing and ready to share it with others. Creation itself, what we call general revelation, creation itself constantly testifies and points to God, to all those who will look and listen. The seasoned, mature believer does the same, trusting that God's word never returns void and that God's works are never, ever in vain. Finally, we read in verse 16, with the mighty deeds of the Lord God, I will come, I will remind them of your righteousness, yours alone. In reading this verse, I was reminded of how everything starts to get smaller and smaller when you take off in an airplane. As you get higher and higher, things begin to disappear. You can still see the roads, but if you go high enough, eventually you can no longer see the vehicles on them, and you certainly can't see the people in them either. Individual homes, whole communities, even entire towns and cities become nothing more than a dot on the surface of the earth. The things that seem so big to us on the ground can quickly become so small in the air that we can't even see them. It is possible for us to become so caught up in the small things in life that we can't see the bigger picture, especially from God's perspective. God's view and His mighty deeds should never be far from our thoughts, for it gives us a means to evaluate what is truly important in life. While we may be tempted to focus on just our life and what God is doing or not doing in our life, we can quickly lose sight of the fact that there are nearly 8 billion people now alive on this planet, and God is at work in some way in every one of those lives, including the very interactions of those 8 billion people. We should be in a constant state of awe regarding what God has done in the past, what He's doing in the present, and what He has promised will occur in the future. as well as why he does the things he does, as we remind ourselves how great and mighty he is, as well as each other, especially with respect to all of his attributes, but as today we see in the psalm, his righteousness. For you and I are completely unable to make ourselves righteous before him, but only through the life, death, and resurrection of his Son, Jesus Christ, are we able to stand before him, declared by him and him alone to be righteous. It is important then in our worship services as well as in our private lives that we share the promises, the faithfulness, and the hope that we have in Christ. How that hope causes us to praise him, to witness and to testify about him, as well as to remind ourselves and each other of the mighty works that he has done. It is important that we pass on to the generations that come after us, to our children, our grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, how God has been faithful to us throughout our lives and how he will be faithful throughout theirs as well. Brothers and sisters, the simple truth is that not everyone who is born will live to see an older age. Life and the length of our life is a blessing that is solely determined by God. And while getting older has certain issues related to it, there are also many, many, many blessings as well as responsibilities that go along with it. Now, I would encourage each of you to take the time today to read this psalm in its entirety, because I'm not going to go over the rest of it in this sermon, and see the greater picture of what God is telling us about our life and about his plans and purposes for each of us. And let it serve as a reminder then to all of us of just how much he loves us, how much he blesses us, and how much he is present in all of our days, however many that may be. That each of us may fully appreciate the lives that we have here and the hope of the life that we have to come and the responsibilities that go along with the blessing of being called sons and daughters of the one true and living God. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, forgive us for our complaints, for those things that either happen to us or happen around us in our lives that we just flat out don't like. And Father, again, we're not denying the reality, especially the reality of the consequences of sin in this world. But even there, Lord, help us not to minimize that sin. Help us to always appreciate the magnitude of the sacrifice that you made for us, even as we saw in our responsive reading today, that you loved us well before any of us even had an inclination, even the inclination to love you back. Lord, we do thank you for how you do protect us, how you see the things that go on in our lives and how you purposely at times have us to go through those to build our faith, to be used, to be able to witness and to testify to others of how great a God you truly are. Father, help us to have eyes that see the positives. Again, not denying and sticking our head in the sand, trying to ignore the realities of getting older and losing loved ones and having problems that seem to persist and go on and on and on. But Lord, help us to be able to focus on you, focus on your goodness, focus on your promises, on your faithfulness, that we might be those vessels, faithful to the end and always willing to tell of the experiences that we've had and how you have proven your faithfulness even to us. Strengthen us, Lord, as we continually hope in you, praise you, testify to what you've done in our lives, that you might be honored, praised, and worthy of all that you have done in all of our worship. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
The first Sunday of the month, we are privileged to be able to celebrate communion. There hopefully are plenty of elements there around you. Please take a moment and navigate the precarious situation with taking off the cellophane there and then using the wafer. Actually, someone told me last time we did this that if you take the whole thing off to begin with, it's easier to actually do the wafer, but I forgot to do that. So, but just be careful with the foil that you can spill in there. We celebrate and remember that Last Supper, that last Passover meal that we celebrated with the disciples. They weren't happy because he had expressed to them, even before that, he had expressed to them that something was going to happen to them. In that Last Supper, as John records so vividly, there is a great deal that he relayed to them as well. Basically said, I'm going away. And having followed him, having learned, having matured, having strength, their faith strengthened, really even just becoming accustomed to having him around for 3 years. It was not easy at all for them to go ahead here. One, that he was going away. And then secondly, he had alluded to them multiple times in terms of the trial that he was going to go through. Even the betrayal that he outlined to them in that Last Supper, which all just must have been extremely shocking to them. But yet, he still found the time and the words to comfort them, promising that, first of all, he was going to prepare a place for them. But second of all, he wasn't going to leave them abandoned in any way whatsoever, that he would be sending the Holy Spirit to them. Now, I know that all that is not what we typically see in the verses regarding the actual Last Supper with regards to the bread and the wine. But I say that all of you today, certainly in light of these recent tragedies that the Gilliland family and we as their family as well are sharing with them today. But it is important for us to remember that as we mourn and grieve, which it is certainly healthy, it is certainly normal, and it is certainly something that we do. It is certainly not a sin. Anyway whatsoever to mourn and grieve, but that we also don't lose hope, the hope that we have in what Christ was getting ready to do, in remembrance of him in terms of where he was going and why he was going there, that he called us to remember this particular sacrament and to do it often as we remember tremendous sacrifice that he made for us. And so, on that evening, as they were not seated at the table, forget Leonardo da Vinci's rendition of the Last Supper that was not anywhere at all what it would look like. But as they were all on the floor there, leaning in towards the center, at some point Jesus, he took the bread, he broke the bread, he blessed the bread, and he said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you. Take and eat." And that wasn't shocking enough. He then took the cup full of wine. He blessed it, gave thanks to the Lord for it as well. And he said, "Take this cup, the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, will be shed for you and for all men, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." Brothers and sisters, join me now as we remember this tremendous sacrifice, this act of love that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit did for each and every one of us. Father God, we thank you with as much appreciation as we can give to you with respect to what you have done for us. How we can't even begin to fathom the magnitude of the fact that you did it for each and every one of us, and that there's lots of us that you did it for. That anyone that would hear and accept this gift with a gracious heart, with a sincere heart, trusting in you as their one and only Lord and Savior, would be declared righteous before the Father. We thank you for Jesus' determination, for his commitment, for his steadfastness. He didn't have to go to that cross for us. He could have called 1,000 angels or just one. Nothing would have happened. But we thank you for the hope of heaven and cross, that this life is not all that there is, that because of his blood that we have been cleansed, we too will be resurrected from the dead to be able to live forever in eternity with you in heaven. It's in Jesus' name that we pray.
I believe our invitational is 342,
yes.
Just as I am.
From this place, may we be those viewers, may we be those vessels reflecting who you are to a world that desperately needs to know you and to receive you. We ask all this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.